Good morning.
Good morning.
Happy Mother's Day. It's good to see everybody this morning and those that are worshiping from home. We thank you for worshiping with us today. Do have a few announcements. Golf on Monday at 5 o'clock. Sunday school for all ages is at 10:15. CWF Mother's Day dinner will be May the 13th at 6:30 at Pendleton Hills. Again? Thursday is the 13th, is that correct?
Yeah.
Okay.
I knew they changed, but I didn't know what
right. They were. Yeah, that was the last account I had. If not, just check with the ladies from CWF. Asking for volunteers to go to Camp Wakandaho to get it ready. That's this Saturday. And then graduation Sunday is May the 23rd. Is there any other announcements as far as announcements go? Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, as we come to you in the stillness of this morning in prayer, dear Lord, we do thank you for hearing our petitions this morning as we lift our prayers up to you, knowing that you hear every prayer and you answer every prayer and in your way and in your time, not in the world's way or the world's time, but your will shall be done in each and every case. Dear Lord, as we lift those up this morning that we have added to our prayer list for those that have lost loved ones this week, we ask that you are especially close to them, that they can feel your comfort, that they can feel your peace that can only come from you as they grieve the loss of a loved one. For those that need physical healing that we have added today, Lord, we just ask that you intervene in each one of those situations, that you give them the physical healing that they need. We know that you are the greatest physician of all, and if it is thy will, that you can lay your hand upon them and restore their health. If that is not your plan, dear Lord, we just ask for peace and comfort for them. Dear Lord, let us be with all mothers today. We ask for a blessing for those that are still here with us. Also a blessing for those that have gone on. Be with our country, dear Lord, and we ask that our leaders look for guidance before making any decisions. We pray that those are pleasing in your eyes. For those that are traveling this week, we just ask for traveling mercies upon them, watch over them, keep them safe, and bring them back to us next week. And all these things in the name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. As we give thanks for our offering, we had a good offering last week, so regardless of how it comes, we just ask for blessings upon it. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we do thank you for those that have given so unselfishly this week. And dear Lord, we just ask that you lay your hands upon this offering and that you bless it wherever it may go, whoever it may be a blessing to. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As we come to the table today, and as last week we talked about Jesus in human form, today I want to talk about Jesus Christ as the Holy Spirit. And I think that's, you know, the Spirit that moves within each and every one of us. So as we come to the table today, I want you to feel the Spirit of Christ, not only here at the table, but also in you as you partake of these emblems that he died on the cross for us for. Let us pray.
Our dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for bringing us to this table on this beautiful Sabbath morning. And we ask that you bless us and all those who could not be with us as we partake of this loaf, for we know it represents the broken body of our Christ that died on that cross in order that we may have everlasting life. In his precious name we pray. Amen.
On that night in the upper room when Jesus took the bread, he blessed it, he broke it, and gave it to the disciples, saying, "This is my body which is broken for you, and as often as you eat of it, do so in remembrance of me."
Let us pray. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we are again thankful for this Lord's Day morning and for the opportunity that we have to come together to worship. Most of all, Father, we are thankful for the ability to come around this thy table to partake of this cup, which is symbolic of Christ's spilled blood, who gave up his life on the cross of Calvary, so that we may have life and have it everlasting. And Father, we ask who partake of this cup that you will guide, guard, and direct us in all that we do. These things we ask in Christ's name. Amen.
And in the like manner, Jesus also took the cup, saying, "This is the spilled blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many. And as often as you drink of it, do so in remembrance of me." And drink ye all of it. Today's scripture reading comes from Acts chapter 10, verses 44 through 48. And while Peter was still speaking, the Holy Spirit fell upon all who heard the word. And the circumcised believers who had come with Peter were astounded that the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out even on to the Gentiles. For they had heard them speaking in tongues and extolling God. And then Peter said, "Can anyone withhold the water for baptizing these people who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have?" So he ordered them to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. And then they invited him to stay for several days. May God richly bless the reading and understanding of the Holy Word. When I was young, I would ask Mom who was her favorite. And of course, she would always say me, until one of my other brothers and sisters would ask the same question, and she would always say that, you know, that they were also her favorite. And she loved us all just as Jesus loves all of us. As Luke writes today in Acts, that the Holy Spirit not only fell upon the circumcised, or the Jews, but also the Gentiles, or us. And as I want to look at this scripture reading today, it's a short reading, very short reading, but I think it has some very valid points in it. And I want to look at the Holy Spirit and then in baptizing and then what it means to stay with others of like faith. So let's take a look, Brian, at that first point there, the Holy Spirit. What is the Holy Spirit? Or who is the Holy Spirit? Maybe is a better way of thinking about that. How would you define the Holy Spirit? Well, there's several different ways or several different definitions of the Holy Spirit. One of them says it's the third person of the Trinity. Another one says God as spiritually active in the world. The Bible gives names of Jehovah God or the Son of Jesus Christ, but not anywhere will you find a name for the Holy Spirit. When the Christian martyr Stephen was given the miraculous vision of heaven, he only saw two people. The Bible says, being full of the Holy Spirit, gazing into heaven, and caught sight of God's glory and of Jesus standing at his right hand. But the Holy Spirit wasn't there. I think someone defined the Holy Spirit this way, and I think the best way is that the Holy Spirit is God's hands and fingers or breath that works through us. So we are an extension of God and of Jesus Christ, and that Holy Spirit is within us and it operates within us. Now we know that sometimes we are lacking in spirit. Maybe it's one of those times when you feel you have very little spirit. And then there'll be other times when the spirit is really within you and you can feel the spirit working within you. I want you to think about it this way. I want you to take your arm, your dominant arm, and I want you to put it beside you. And I want you to tie it off for a month so it can't move. Now, there'll be two things that will happen. The first thing is that you will learn to function with your less dominant hand. And then at the end of that month, when you take the wrapping off, your dominant hand will be almost useless for a little while, until it regains motion and movement and function. So the spirit can become stronger if you allow it, or it can become less if you allow it. And Billy Graham says if you don't recognize the spirit, that it will leave you altogether. I'm not sure that I agree with that, But I think you can ignore the Spirit to the point that it may be hard to rekindle. You remember the story of the talents. Remember the master that he give talents or money, denarii, to each of his three slaves according to their abilities. Remember that? And the first two doubled their talents when he came back. And the third one was so afraid that he buried his talent. He didn't even have the good sense to put it in the bank to earn interest. But he buried his talent. And when the master came back, he said, "See, I have given you back what you have given me." And we know the rest of the story that he gave more to the first two slaves that increased the talents. And he didn't give anything to the one that didn't. So we are entrusted with the Holy Spirit. Now, can we move the Holy Spirit in others as well as in ourselves? I hope we can. I hope we can. We need to be that example. So let's take a look at point two about baptizing. Now, baptizing, Peter says in verse 47 and 48 that can anyone, and I like the way Peter says this, can anyone withhold the water from baptizing these people who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have? So he ordered them to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Remember last week as we talked about choosing a side. This is what he's talking about here, as he is talking about Jesus Christ. And I'm sure on that day when all of the Spirit, it said it spilled over to the Gentiles and they were speaking in tongues, that the Spirit would have been so thick, it would have been like a fog, or it would have been like, so thick that you almost have to wipe it away, that you can feel it that good. Have you ever thought about, or have you ever been part of the Holy Spirit that way? You know, one of those hot showers when you come out into the bathroom and there's steam everywhere. That's sometimes the way the Holy Spirit feels as it works upon us and in us and in others like people. And I think that's what Luke is trying to write today here in Acts of how dominating that Spirit was. That Spirit was that dominating. Baptism. It's one of my favorite things to do. That and baby dedications, that's great. Weddings are good. Funerals are bad. They shouldn't be. It should be a celebration, but it's, I love to do baptisms. And I want you to think back to your baptism. You think back to the day that you were baptized. Was the water cold? Or was the water hot? Or was it just right? Was it in a baptismal? Was it in the river? Was it in a creek? How cool would it have been to be baptized in an ocean? I think that would be cool, to be baptized in an ocean. As I baptize someone, there is a look upon their face, and I'm the only one that gets to see it. You can't see it as they come out of that water. They are transformed. There is I can't describe what it looks like, but if you've ever had that opportunity to see it, you know what I'm talking about. It is a transforming, look upon their face. They take a whole different look when they come out of the water and their sins have been washed away. It's just something that you have to experience. You really do. Let's take a look at that third point. Staying with others of like faith. In the late 60s, all throughout the 70s, in the early part of the 80s, there was a belief among the disciples of Christ that if you sent your kids off to camp, and if you took them to district functions, that these disciple kids would marry and they would have disciple babies. And that was a way of growing the church. I mean, you think about it, at that time there wasn't a lot of other outside influences to do. So you didn't have a very good chance of meeting someone else. You know, if you were diligent of sending them to camp and diligent to send them to district functions, you know, pretty good chance that disciples would marry disciples. It wasn't a bad philosophy, really, but it wouldn't work in today's world, really. It's good to be around people of like faith. It's a support system that we need as we go throughout life. It's reassurance that we all stumble and fall, But if we're among people of like faith, someone will pick us up or tell a story of how they stumbled and fell, and then it'll all be okay. But we can't remain within just people of like faith. We were called to spread the word throughout the world, to the four corners of the earth, just not among like faith. So I always refer it to as having my batteries charged. Coming to church is recharging my batteries for a week so I can go out and deal with the world and those in it for a week. And then I come back and I get my my batteries recharged. And I hope that's the way you think of it as well. It's good to be with people of like faith, but we can't live within that world only. We need to spread to others. So as we close today, and haven't talked much about mothers, but as we close, I want to read this story. Hope I get through this story. It's The Godly Mother, is the name of the story. The young mother set her foot on the path of life. "This is the long way," she asked. And the guide said, "Yes, and the hard way. And you will be old before you reach the end of it. But the end will be better than the beginning." But the younger mother was happy when she would not believe that anything could be more better than these years. So she played with her children, gathering flowers for them along the way, and bathed them in cool streams. And the sun rose on them, and the young mother cried, "Nothing will ever be lovelier than this." Then the night came and the storm, and the path was dark, and the children shook with fear and cold. And the mother drew them close and covered them with her mantle. And these children said, "Mother, we are not afraid, for you are near, and no harm can come." And then morning came, and there was a hill ahead, and the children climbed and grew weary, and the mother was weary. But at all times she said to the children, "A little patience, and we are there." So the children climbed, and when they reached the top, the mother said, "We would not have done it without you." And the mother, when she lay down at night, looked at the stars and said, This is the better day than the last for my children, and have learned fortitude in the face of hardness. Yesterday, I gave them courage. Today, I gave them strength. And the next day came, and the strange cloud, which darkened the earth, and the clouds of war and hate and evil, and the children groped and stumbled, and the mother said, "Look up, lift your eyes to the light." And the children looked, and they saw the clouds and everlasting glory, and it guided them beyond the darkness. And at night, the mother said, "This is the best day of all, for I have shown my children God." And days went on, and weeks and months and years, and the mother grew old, and she was little and bent. But her children were tall and strong and walked with courage. And when the way was rough, they lifted her, and she was as light as a feather. And the last came to the hill, and beyond, they could see a shining road with glory, with golden gates flung wide. And Mother said, I have reached the end of my journey, and now I know the end is better than the beginning, for my children can walk alone, and their children after them. And the children said, you will walk with us, Mother, even though you have gone through the gates. And they stood and they watched her as she went alone. And the gates closed after her. And they said, we cannot see her, but she is with us still. A mother like ours is more than a memory. She is a living presence. Your mother is always with you. She is the whisper of the leaves as you walk down the street. She is the smell of the bleach in your freshly laundered socks. And she is the cool hand on your brow when you're not well. Your mother lives inside your laughter and crystallized in every tear. She is the place you came from, the first home. She's the map you follow with every step you take. She's your first love and your first heartbreak. And nothing on earth can separate you. Not time, not space, not even death. Thought for the week. Are you Jesus' favorite? Amen. Ordinary. Let us pray. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, we do thank you for today, and we thank you for our mothers and what an influence they are on our lives. Be with us and watch over us and keep us safe this week. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.